Welcome to another episode of Veterans Viewpoints. Tonight we're going to talk a little bit about the new director of Edward Hines Hospital and some of the visions that she has for her position. Ms. Joan Ricard assumed her duties as director of Edward Hines Hospital in 2012. She manages one of the largest healthcare facilities in the VA system on a 147-acre campus. Edward Hines Hospital offers primary, extended, and specialty care, including rehabilitation for blind, spinal cord injury, and cardiovascular patients. The Edward Hines Hospital healthcare facilities include outpatient clinics in Kankakee, Elgin, Oak Lawn, Aurora, LaSalle, and Joliet. There are numerous programs at Hines, including the new medical mobile unit and the women's healthcare initiatives, and some of the initiatives that Ms. Joan Ricard has. Ms. Ricard began her VA career in 1997 and has served in numerous VA facilities across our great country. Her education includes a Master's of Healthcare Administration from Baylor University and a Bachelor of Science in Nursing from Marquette University, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Ms. Joan Ricard and her visions of VA care, Hines Hospital, her visions, a mobile medical unit, and women's health or women's veterans health care initiatives when we return. This segment, or this episode of Veterans Viewpoints, is dedicated to Dr. Henry Hank Allen, Jr. Ms. Ricard, thank you for accepting our invitation to be on our show.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
That's fantastic, and welcome to the western suburbs of Chicago, and it's nice to see a new face at Hines.
Thank you.
Tell me something about the process. I mean, when you were selected, or when you put your hat into the ring, so to speak, for the position, to follow the footsteps of Ms. Sharon Hellman. What were some of your thoughts and what were some of your visions? Should you say, if I got this job, what would you want to do?
Probably the two biggest things that I was looking for if I would get this position is to really say that the Hines VA Hospital is the employer of choice for applicants wanting to get jobs there and our current employees, along with being a healthcare provider of choice for all of our veterans in our catchment area.
And what do you want to, as the director of Hines, what do you want to convey to the veterans that use the facility and to those that are either on the edge about going there or the ones that are coming home from our current situation in the world?
Well, I really want them to know that the VA in general, and this includes Hines, has really transformed itself from what the VA was years and years ago. Some people may remember some of the things that had happened, like in the movie Born on the 4th of July. The VA is no longer that type of a facility at all, and Hines is a model for that. The VA provides outstanding quality care with great, great clinical outcomes. And that's one of the main reasons that I have been with the VA for almost 34 years, is because I am very proud of what we do. And also we have a very, very noble mission of serving our veterans. The VA transformed itself initially under the direction of Dr. Ken Kaiser when he actually started looking at our clinical outcomes and really monitoring the care that we provide. And through that, we have really benchmarked and have been a leader in healthcare and clinical outcomes. And that not only comes from us as the VA being very proud of what we do, but it also comes from other people. There's lots of articles out there, but I'd really like to quote for you, Philip Longman actually was approached by Fortune magazine a while back, and he was asked by them to actually go and find a person, a facility, whatever, that could transform our current healthcare system in a crisis in the United States. And Unfortunately, he didn't come back with the answer they wanted because his answer was the VA.
Really?
And I can just give you
a
quote out of his book. And again, his book is called Best Care Anywhere, Why VA Healthcare is Better Than Yours. He actually has even updated it and gave a second edition that was published in 2010. But let me just read you at least two paragraphs out of here because I think it's just great demonstration of the quality care that we provide. He says, in 2007, the Milbank Quarterly published a study showing the VA outperforming Medicare, Medicaid, and commercial health care in key quality indicators, including diabetic care, control of hypertension, and preventative care such as mammography. The disparities are often stunning. For example, the VA successfully treats its patient with high blood pressure in 77% of cases, while the commercial healthcare success rate is only 67%. And low-tech medicine is not the only area where the VA excels. In the late 1990s, the VA adopted a national surgical quality improvement program that was soon initiated by private sector surgeons, but with less than perfect results. In 2009, for example, the Journal of Surgical Research published a study of outcomes of coronary surgery at a VA hospital versus other hospitals, even though the VA patients were considerably sicker on average, suffering nearly twice the rate of myocardial infarctions or heart attacks. Their mortality rate after surgery was barely half that of those treated outside the VA system.
I'm impressed. I'm impressed.
And this is from someone who does not work for the VA.
Well, what has Mr. Longman, is he in the healthcare business or?
No, he's not. He said in his book that he was really encouraged to do this because his wife was diagnosed with breast cancer and died shortly after her treatment. And they had gone to a very outstanding clinic, but he had seen holes and gaps in the system. And so when they approached him, he just felt compelled that he wanted to go ahead and continue to research this and do this.
And so what brought him to the VA system?
He was just looking around at all sorts of systems and also doing research articles and had brought him to this conclusion.
Are you going to make all the employees at Hines read this?
Of course.
Actually,
I think every other people should. I mean,
the
issue is also, I think the VA has a negative image at times. We are a very public figure, and we do expose sometimes our faults or the mistakes that we make. But if you compare that to what's going on in the private sector, we are outstanding.
Exactly.
And I think that if veterans realize some of the quality of care that really goes on in our systems, they would be much more likely to come and get care there.
As we talked before the show, I only registered at Hines maybe 2 years ago. Up until that point, even though I was eligible many years ago to seek treatment there or to have my health care, I just had this vision of I don't want to set foot in this place. And when I did, actually the reason it came about was my primary care physician, his father is a World War II vet and has gone to Hines, and he's a doctor and he loves it. So I said, look, if this doctor Santilli loves it, I think I'm gonna go check it out. And I'll tell you what, I'd had a lot of stuff done there. Lab work, I even had a colonoscopy a couple years ago and it was fantastic. And I will say this, the VA hospital, Hines, at least, has all the new bells and whistles, all the toys, all the modern equipment. I think it's fantastic, and healthcare is fantastic. But this is a surprise, and if somebody wanted to buy or pick up this book and read this, where would they go? Just like to a bookstore?
Any bookstore. You can buy it online.
Hold that up for the camera so they can see that. Best care anywhere, folks, if you want to, especially veterans. Go out there to the Barnes & Noble and put this book in. The catalog is on the back number there, so it'd be an interesting book. I think I'm going to pick that up and read it. I think it should be I think every American Legion Hall and VFW Hall in America should have that available. I think it's fantastic. That's quite a surprise. So, in considering that, though, and knowing how you are passionate about this and for your 30 years in the career in a VA, how would you convince those veterans all and the people in general or the veterans to come into Hines, to come and seek it? You're a pretty good salesman so far.
Thank you. A lot of it is word of mouth. And also, I think they need to, again, if they know the quality and mm-hmm. people like you, if you spread the word and say how great it is, but it's also outreach efforts as well.
Okay.
And we want to make sure that veterans understand that they, if they're eligible for care, that we are there to provide that service for them.
Absolutely.
And we hope that they come and join the system.
As essentially the CEO of a major medical facility, what role do you see your hospital, our hospital, our mm-hmm. Hines, playing in the community at large?
I think sometimes people don't understand the depth and breadth that we care that we provide to our veterans. We not only provide primary care, preventative care, acute care, mental health care, we also provide home care services, we provide long-term care services, we provide hospice care. So we are the spectrum. We are a pharmacy, we give medications, we are the prosthetic items. We are the spectrum of health care that we provide to our veterans.
Home care and hospice, I think as the baby boomer generation ages a little bit, I believe that those are considerations or those are kind of medical care that people mm-hmm. will be focused on. And of course, when they turn on the TV, there's just a deluge of information out there. I don't see the VA though saying to our veterans, to our families, hey, don't go by what the commercials, come by us. How would you convey that? How would you combat that? How would you get that word out?
And we do that in a variety of ways. We have, the VA nationally has a great website. We also, the Hines VA has a website that anyone can go to. We're doing a variety of outreach type of efforts. And also, we go to all of the deployment type of things that the military is having so
okay.
that we can educate them
okay.
as well on their benefits.
That's interesting you brought that up about going to the deployments or the welcome home.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I understand, the Department of Defense and the VA system have worked tirelessly. Can you explain a little bit about, because I remember when I separated from the service, my records were somewhere in St. Louis in a big building, but now that's changed a little bit. Aren't the records kind of going right to VA?
Well, we're trying to get much better at that, especially with some of the comp and pen exams that we do so
okay.
that the veterans get their disability evaluations. And so we're working very hard with the military so that when these active duty soldiers are getting out of the military, especially for medical reasons,
mm-hmm.
that we are right there doing their exams. But also when they're coming out of the military, that we go and we try to educate them on all of their benefits. And we give them brochures and stuff. The problem is, a lot of times, is they're so anxious to get back to their loved ones that they're really not paying attention. their hearts and their minds are in a little different spot than learning about the VA. And sometimes they think, oh, I'm young and I don't need to be
mm-hmm.
there and the VA is just for older veterans. That's not true. That just definitely is not true. I think there's a perception that, you know, we're not there for women veterans either. And that's just totally not true. We are there for all eligible veterans. And for individuals that are getting out of the service, they're automatically eligible for 5 years.
Okay, I'm glad you brought that up, Joan, because there seems to be, I would imagine a lot of veterans are confused. And granted, they're getting out of service now, they're eligible for health care for 5 years. After that five-year period, what is the eligibility criteria to continue the health care at VA, at Hines?
For then we're looking at whether or not they've established a service-connected disability or not.
Okay.
And so, and that's why we're giving them the five-year period of time to look at the long-range plan, the long-range effects of what had happened in the military.
Okay, now, the type of discharge for the viewer that maybe heard something from the lunchroom lawyers and all those people. What is the basic eligibility criteria to receive care at VA, at Hines?
Well, again, if they've recently discharged, right. anyone getting out of the military is eligible for 5 years.
Okay.
And if not, we do, there is a place that you can go on the website or you can call up our eligibility hotline and you could go ahead and fill out, you need to fill out a form called 1010 Easy, and there we're looking up your financial criteria, because if
okay.
you're not service connected, there is some financial criteria.
Okay.
There is a cutoff, and I can't give you that exact amount. It changes sometimes from year to year.
Sure.
But there, so if you're not service connected, there is a financial criteria. If you're make above a certain level, then you're going into a different category.
And this includes wartime era?
Oh, God, yeah. Everyone.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Everyone, okay. And so basically,
except for unless you're dishonorably discharged.
Okay, now that's a big one, yeah. And that's another topic entirely. The websites that you mentioned, the hotlines, they will play when people will be able to see them at the bottom of the screen. So folks, if you need some of those information, just keep looking at the bottom of the screen because they will appear periodically through this interview. And I've been over to Hines recently. As a matter of fact, I was over there, and I usually try to approach Hines off by Viola,
mm-hmm.
off of the First Avenue exit or entrance. And much to my surprise, that back avenue was closed for construction. There's a lot of construction going on.
There are. We have over 190 projects going on right now.
Really?
Yes.
All over.
All over. We're really trying to look at the infrastructure to make it much more customer friendly, although during construction times it may not feel like that because we're directing you to go into a different way. But we're really trying to make things much more customer friendly. The front entrance hopefully will be done by January 1st if we all keep our fingers crossed. But I think that will be a great improvement just to the aesthetic when you're first pulling up to the VA.
Well, we have to keep in mind that any construction project in Illinois can take eons. So I think we're pretty well versed and used to delays. And some of the other things that we're talking about is, as we said earlier, you have some visions. And you mentioned them at the start of the program. What would be your, when you said to yourself, I'm going to throw my hat in there, I want this. Everybody's going to know that Joan Ricard has been here. What would a couple of those things be? The most important things in your viewpoint?
Again, customer
okay.
service is what we're really looking
okay.
for. I want to make sure that veterans want to come to us and that they really want to be there and that they can call the Hines VA their VA of choice, their healthcare provider of choice. And like I said, I know that we provide good quality care, but some people look at quality care in a different perspective, such as how the place looks, or have we greeted them in the most effective manner possible,
mm-hmm.
or is our signage. And so I really want to reach out to the veterans and really ask them, what is it that they want from us, and how can we make this their VA?
Excellent. Okay. Well, that sounds pretty interesting. I know that there's some more interesting ideas and visions that you have during the rest of the program. And when we return, we're going to talk about some of the outreach programs that Hines has, plus something that I think is very important for today's veterans, and that's the available health care delivery for the women veterans. Outreach programs and women's health care at Hines when we return. Welcome back to Veterans Viewpoints. As I mentioned earlier, another important aspect of Hines VA is the outreach and the outreach programs that are available at Hines. Among them are a brand new medical mobile unit. Did I say that
That's
right?
That's correct.
I'm dying to see this thing myself. I'm just having visions of what it looks like and what it can do. We also have something called, like any VA hospital anywhere, there's an emphasis on suicide prevention and how Hines is approaching that. There's also talk with the Make the Connection something that I saw on the internet, and Ms. Ricard will explain that in a little bit more detail about what that program is and how good it is. And something for the younger veterans, something that I try to ignore to the best of my abilities, is this, all the various avenues of social media like Facebook, Twitter, or Twitter, or what is it?
Twitter.
Twitter, yeah. See, I even screwed that up. I'll tell you, I stay away from that. I'm afraid of it. And something that we talked about real briefly, something I'm not aware of, my healthy vet. So, Joan, run with it. Talk about each of these things and why they're important for the veterans to know.
Okay.
And the families of veterans.
Yes. So, we recently acquired a mobile medical unit, and it is a large RV, basically, that has been equipped with capacity to have two exam areas, one in the front and one in the back.
Wow.
And we also have a private area for counseling sessions. It is totally equipped with Wi-Fi. I know this is a little techie for you. So that we can go ahead and hook up to the internet and actually enroll veterans if we're out in the community somewhere. And we also have refrigeration for medications if we need some. And we also have mini centrifuge type things where we can draw blood and keep our blood at a place where we need to until we can get it back to the home site. I think what we're looking at for this van is a couple of different things that will be useful for us. First of all, we, despite that we have our community-based outpatient clinics, there still are other rural areas where we do not have the penetration rate for veterans that we would like to. So in some of these smaller areas, we'd like to take that mobile medical unit out there to find out whether or not that there is a need and if these veterans would want to come and get enrolled with us and get health care. And if there is a great need, we might even then decide to have that mobile medical unit come there, you know, once a month, twice a month, or whatever, so that these veterans could be seen right there in their home site.
That's incredible.
The other thing that we're going to be looking at doing also is taking it to different events. One, so that people get a better understanding of the benefits that are eligible for our veterans, and also that we could enroll them right on site. So an example is on September 1st, we went to Naperville. They had an event there. Also on September 29th, the mobile medical unit went to Cantini, where they had a welcome home event. And in November, to a Veterans Day parade in Utica. And these are just things just to get people more aware of what the VA is and what we're all about and what the benefits are for our veterans. Now, some individuals, some veterans just think, oh, other people deserve it more. But that's not true. Everyone who served their country and is eligible for care should feel like that the VA is theirs and that they could access care.
This mobile medical unit, my thoughts are racing already. I just think this would be incredible. So, if somebody, say a post commander somewhere that is a really nice post commander in a local community of a great post, wants to try to schedule this for an event, who do they contact?
You can contact our public affairs officer, and her number is 708-202-8838. Her name is Maureen Diamond.
Is she reliable?
She's very reliable.
Oh, okay.
But we're also going to have on our website a spot where you could go ahead and request the mobile medical unit on that. Again,
okay.
It's going to be, we're going to have to schedule it and make sure that we're available to come at that time.
So if somebody were to go, say, tomorrow and try to schedule something for the next Memorial Day parade, they'd have a pretty good chance of having a selection?
I would think so.
Okay. Well, I'll have to pass that word along to somebody. But we're also talking about some other critical things, though, and the some of the sadder things. I think this mobile medical unit is incredibly interesting. I think it's going to do a lot for Hines. Does any other hospital have that? I mean, any other VA?
I believe that there are so far five others in the country.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
And I think your public affairs officer was kind of boasting that on that, is it Facebook?
Yes.
One of those social things?
Yes.
You have the fourth largest?
Fourth largest in the VA network. so among the VA. But it is fairly large, and it's actually provides, we actually have more followers than a lot of the other larger healthcare community healthcare systems.
Okay.
It is a, you know, it's a great way for people to find information. We post information about what's going on at the Hines VA or in our community-based outpatient clinics. And other information that veterans may need information about, like we post when our flu shots season okay. starts and things like that.
Now, I know the students at LT are going to think of me as a dinosaur of some kind when it comes to Facebook or Twitter, I don't know. But I guess the Facebook, I looked at it years ago and I kind of just backed away, but basically it's just like a post, right? You just put on information, you could see information about other people or
we post stuff, and then sometimes people will write back to us.
Okay. And the same thing with
Twitter. Yes.
And what basically that's just like it's email in one spot?
It's a social networking site, so people talk, we say okay. something, people respond back to us or respond okay. to each other.
I think the younger veterans are into that. I believe that the younger veterans are very social conscious, and this is how they communicate.
Definitely.
And I guess Hines has taken the lead. At least you're part of that.
We're trying to be on the leading edge of some of that.
Now, compared to some of the other large medical facilities that we have, the other major mm-hmm. healthcare providers, are they even near VA on this? Do they have their Facebooks or anything else?
They have similar web pages as well.
Are they as modern as Hines seems to be?
I think they're comparable. I just think we have more followers.
Because there's more veterans.
Yes.
And we're trying to be
much more proactive. And I think our veterans, especially the ones that have been in the military, they're accustomed to this. Most of them get laptops when they're going overseas.
And that's true.
So they understand all this stuff. They're communicating with their family at home, by video camera and stuff. So they're used to these types of things. That's how they want to be communicated to. And we're trying to meet those needs of our veterans.
On previous episodes of the program, we have had guests from Hines and from Jesse Brown. I don't think there's enough emphasis or enough can be said about the suicide prevention initiatives that Hines is taking. That's part of the outreach program.
I think we're doing that both nationally and at the Hines facility, and along with all of our community-based outpatient clinics. We have really wrapped up enhanced our staff for mental health services, but we're also really reaching out to the community. We have mental health providers at our community-based outpatient clinics. We also do some telemental health, so if we have other things going on at some of the CBOCs and we need a more advanced practitioner, we can, through telehealth initiatives, go back to the main facility and get some additional services that way. And really reaching out to our veterans to see if they really do have symptoms that not only the veterans, but also family members, friends, families, refer them to the VA. That's what we're here for. We have a lot of returning veterans that have PTSD or they have traumatic brain injury. The problem is we teach them to be soldiers and we teach them to be tough, and the stigma of mental health is not a very good stigma for some reason. But it's a medical condition like anything else, and we need to understand that and we need to treat it as such and take away the negative stigma regarding that. We have found that if we get these veterans in and we start treating them right from the start instead of waiting for a long time, we have a much better outcome with these individuals. So if you see individuals that have symptoms of depression or feel like they're worthless or feel, have some outrageous behavior like road rage or something like that, that's the time we need to start seeing them right away.
That's a great point. Sometimes family members or friends don't want to interfere, thinking that, for whatever reason, that maybe it's none of my business, or maybe I shouldn't interfere, but I'm seeing this person and it doesn't seem right. They're not acting right. Is there is there an anonymity with them when they call the VA, or do you say that? How's the person contacted to start the help
nationally
process?
We have a crisis line. That veterans and or family members or whoever can call this line and chat with individuals, and hopefully they'll be able to give the veteran advice and refer them to the facility, and or if it's a family member, give them advice maybe on how to deal with them. It's a great avenue to be able to deal with that. And again, if people have, this is a national hotline, but if anybody has any questions about that, the Hines VA and our mental health staff is I will put them up to any mental health staff in the nation. They are that good, and they are ready and willing to go out and reach out and treat any veteran that is coming knocking at our door.
We have had in previous episodes some of your staff to come out to talk explicitly about homelessness, suicide prevention, PTSD, and they're very talented, they're very educated, they're very compassionate people. They have a passion for the fellow veteran or the veterans. And we're gonna have at the end of the show, we're gonna run something where all these different numbers or websites will be available for the viewer, because there are so many websites and so many telephone numbers that are available. And you also mentioned something now, My Healthy Vet. Explain that. This sounds incredible.
Again, when we're talking about social media, internet sites, et cetera, this is a great way for our veterans to get connected more to their care.
Okay.
And so, if you're a veteran and you're enrolled with us, and you then can enroll in something that's called My Healthy Vet. And once you enroll and get what they call authenticated, you are actually able to go onto this site, and you have your own personal passwords and stuff, so don't share them with anybody. And you are able to actually order your medications online. You are actually able to see your lab results on. So if we draw cholesterol and you wanted to know what it was, you could go on then and go and see what your cholesterol level was. You can also actually enroll in secure messaging. So on this site, you go into the secure message site, and you can actually have a secure message dialogue going on with your primary care team. And eventually, you are also going to be able to actually see all of your progress notes online too. That is yet to come. We don't have a date yet for that, but it is coming.
I can't think of any other, there might be, but I can't think of any other hospital that provides that.
There are some healthcare facilities that are actually starting to do some online enrollment types of stuff. So give us your, go to this website and give us your history and things like that.
Right.
I am not aware. I'd have to do a little bit more research about whether there is any online place where you can actually go on and see your lab results and stuff. I have not seen that or come across that yet.
Is all this possible? Because when you think about the VA, you're really talking about one system nationwide.
Correct.
No matter where you go. And somebody on, say, they may go to a Rush hospital one year, next year they may, depending on their physician, go to Loyola. And so I can see where that's not possible. Well, because VA is basically a unitarian sort of type of thing, no matter where that veteran goes, he'll be able to pull whatever treatment or anything pertaining to him.
Correct. And I think that's a really good point about the VA, and you can take the example of what happened in New Orleans with the hurricane and the veterans that had evacuated there, and any other individual that was trying to seek health care anywhere else, they didn't know what was going on with them. If we had patients with cancer and that were being treated with chemotherapy, the next day they were at some other place and we were able to pull up their whole chemotherapy regime and give that veteran the exact treatment they were getting in New Orleans.
You know, Joan, you just brought up something really so basic and so interesting. If a person, maybe there's something that the VA can really stress to their clients, the veteran clients. If I'm going on vacation someplace, and maybe I should know, say, I'm going to visit my aunt in Seattle. Now, I know where the Madigan Hospital is over in Fort Lewis, but it'd be good to know where the VA hospital is. So when I'm visiting, if something should occur, I'll know where to go, and basically it's not like registering for the first time. I'm already registered in the VA.
Correct.
And we do
that frequently. A lot of times veterans are traveling, they run out of medication, or they get injured or hurt, and they show up at another VA, and we are able to pull up all of their medical records.
Then. That is one nice benefit of being in the VA system.
It is. It's wonderful.
It is. Are there any other things, though, that we haven't touched upon as far as your outreach? And we're going to get into women's veterans health care, because I think that's really critical and important in this day and age for a lot of different reasons. But we've talked upon there's something else that we talked about that I saw and I'm curious about, and I really don't know that much about it, but make the connection. Can you briefly describe what that is?
This is something that VA nationally has rolled out. And what they wanted to do was actually being able to bring the veterans together so that they could talk among themselves. We were just providing a medium for them to do that because the veterans have a lot to say. And there's also some therapeutic value in them being mm-hmm. able to chat with each other. So this is basically a chat type session on the internet where they're chatting with each other
okay.
to talk about their war stories, to talk about their, you know, things that had happened to them so that they feel sometimes that they're not alone there, or they're not by themselves.
How does a person volunteer? I mean, do they just go on this and register themselves?
Yes, they
like
go
I'm
on.
Available.
They go on and they go on to the chat session, and we can also have that. We'll also have that number available for you.
I just think there's a much. The various outreach programs that the modern VA Hines is initiating or has available for our veterans. When we come back, we're going to talk about women veteran healthcare initiatives and availability, something that I think is very, very important for today's society. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm a veteran myself, and I think what's happening today is that an increasing number of women have enlisted in the military, all the branches, and they're playing a much more pivotal and functional and important role in today's military than when I was on active duty a long, long time ago. And as such, they are more exposed to the trauma, the difficulties of military life than ever before. And when they come out of the service, sometimes they are still battling the issues that they've dealt with in the service. And where do they go for the proper professional needed medical health care? And I know Hines has done a terrific job about that, but I believe Ms. Joan Ricard has her own visions and to talk about what Hines is providing for today's woman veteran. Joan?
Okay. Like I said in our first section, what I really want to focus on is being an healthcare provider of choice for all of our veterans. Mm-hmm. And a major focus on that will be our women veterans. Yeah. We've done a lot of things. And one of them is that we have stood up a new women's health clinic, and it is beautiful. It is state of the art. It even has a lactation room to it. So it is beautiful and really geared towards our women veterans so that they have a place themselves. I think sometimes our women veterans feel that they don't want to come to the VA because it's the male VA. And that's not really the case. We are serving about 2,500 women veterans right this instant.
Good. Thank you.
And we need to continue that growth. Women are not always very good about taking care of their health, and there is a disparity in some of the women health numbers that we're looking at and some of the quality care metrics that we actually measure. And a lot of times our women veterans are taking care of their family members and their children and their parents mm-hmm. and are forgetting to take care of themselves. And so we really are trying to make much more of an emphasis that they do need to take care of themselves, and looking at a lot of the prevention screening and focusing on that, that they really need to get these prevention screenings to make sure that they stay healthy. Because if they don't stay healthy, who's going to take care of their family eventually? So we're really focusing on that. But I think there's still another stigma for some of these women veterans, and sometimes some of them have suffered military sexual trauma while in the military. And I think it's difficult for them to even walk into the VA at times. So we're trying to change some of that, really reaching out to these women veterans that have military sexual trauma. We have great military sexual trauma coordinator that works specifically with these women veterans to talk them through their issues and work through some of the things that they have. And also educating our staff too, so that our staff understand, all of our staff understands that what some of these women veterans had gone through. Actually, and it's not just the Hines VA that's working on this. Sure. We're working on this naturally. I can tell you that the secretary of the VA, Secretary Sinshecki, had put out a task force, and actually I was on that task force, to work on women veterans and work on a variety of different issues. We were working on coordinating the care of our women veterans. We're working on employment and training of women veterans, working on the environment for women veterans, etc. And the report should be published fairly shortly. It was put out for comment. We've dealt with those comments, and it will be published very shortly. So this is a passion also to the secretary and the VA nationally, knowing that we're not always meeting the mark with women veterans and that we need to improve that. I can also tell you, at least for the Hines VA, at each of our community-based outpatient clinics, we have providers that have been specialty trained for women's health. So again, everyone has a choice. They can see whatever provider sure. that they want, but if they want someone specially trained in women's health, we have a specific provider at each of our CBO, community-based outpatient clinics, as well as our women's health clinic at the main campus at the Hines facility. You know, we're really trying to look at and really preserve the privacy and the dignity yes. of our female veterans, and you know, and we really need to do that. And we also are really very sensitive to the gender-specific issues that they have. Military sexual trauma is one of them, but also the other types of things that sometimes women veterans have and that they want to go to.
When a woman is still on active duty, are there appropriate guides or are there appropriate steps for a woman to start receiving counseling when she's had this trauma, then kind of seamlessly come into the VA system? To continue
again, I can't address what happens in the military.
Okay.
I can tell you that, you know, we are really trying to work with the military, not only with women veterans, but all veterans,
sure.
to try to have a more seamless transition. And if there are issues, particularly mental health issues or issues such as military sexual trauma, that they try to hand off the veterans to us and refer them to us. Some of that happens through the disability evaluation system, and then mm-hmm. we can aggressively get them in more quickly. Again, some of the outreach efforts that we're trying to do, I'm hoping will help some of that. But again, it's getting the word out to these women veterans to tell them that this really is their VA and
yes.
they deserve this care.
I agree with you. No argument from me. I'm a strong supporter of that. And because women are assuming more of a responsible role in our society. And I'll tell you, I think before our lifetime, we'll still see a first woman president, so who knows what's possible. You mentioned the women's clinic at
mm-hmm.
Hines, and what floor is it on? What wing is it on?
It's on the 12th floor.
Yeah.
And like I said, it's a beautiful, beautiful environment. We have brand new exam rooms. We have new equipment. We have private restrooms for them so they don't have to go in the hallway. I mean, I guess the downside. Just for women.
Okay.
Women veterans.
I won't be able to go up there and take a look.
We would have to close it off and remove all the women to let you go up there.
Fair enough.
The only thing that could probably make it bigger, better, and greater would be to have a totally private entrance where female veterans would not have to go through the, get into the elevator and go up to the 12th floor.
Why didn't they consider it with the construction?
Sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. That didn't happen.
Okay.
But we provide a variety of services in there. We have primary care. We have urology services there. We have mental health services, nutrition service, social work services. So we have the whole gamut.
That's nice. That sounds really good. I mean, they, not to single them out, but I think they need to have this availability. I mean, they are, like I said, they're serving much more of an important role in today's military, and I just wish we could get the word out. How can a local veterans organizations assist you in any capacity with the VA, or especially with this?
I think it's getting the word out and having the people come and get enrolled. They just need to know what their services are. I think even with women veterans, I don't think sometimes they understand that we pay for pregnancies. And we pay for the delivery of the baby. Once the baby's delivered, we pay for that. We never paid for that before, ever.
That's important.
And it's important, and people don't understand that or realize that.
So when you have the National Guard and Reserve units, maybe they get this in detail, you know, when they're in active duty units, but if it's a unit that's a National Guard or Reserve unit, and they're coming back home, or they're up at McCoy when they're having their debriefings, is that information available to them?
Again, we're trying to do as many briefings as we can.
I mean,
to
from the VA, not just Hines.
The VA.
Okay.
McCoy, so probably if they're coming from Fort McCoy, usually Madison or Toma is going there to do the debriefings.
Okay.
And our Veterans Benefits is usually there as well, the Veteran Benefits Department, so that they explain to them about their eligibility for service connections, applying for service connections, and things like that.
Okay. So at these briefings, if somebody wanted to register right away, that's available to them based on where they live?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I think that's great.
But they could even just register there and then go ahead and transfer their care at any point in time.
Okay.
You can transfer your care anytime you want to a different area.
I think that's really important. And I think it's a valuable service that I believe, and I belong to several veterans organizations, and maybe that is something that we can put in the monthly newsletters that each one has, that VA, and Hines especially, has fantastic programs for the woman veteran. And here's the links for that. So I think that's
a great idea. And I think, you know, any way that you can get the word out and help us with these women veterans, it is much appreciated. They served in the military just like their male counterparts, and they deserve this.
Yeah. And it doesn't necessarily mean just the MST. I mean,
no.
It could be in a combat situation that
they're having the same symptoms as their male counterparts. They're having PTSD from the explosions. You know, they're having some of the same type of other medical issues that are coming up that we're seeing. You know, they have traumatic brain as well. And again, their family members, if they can help them and refer them to us, that's what we're there for.
I think your best spokesperson could probably be, she's running for Congress up on the northwest side, and this is not political, so I'm just going to say she's running for Congress, but a woman veteran that she'll bear the marks of her service to her country for the rest of her life. But I think with VA care, she's been able to stay strong, a strong individual. And I mean, wasn't she an undersecretary of VA for a while?
Mm-hmm.
And doing something there, I know that, but she didn't limit. And I think if people, more women know this, that, hey, look at this person, look at it, and she's still serving.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a fine example of what the VA has done for one person. I mean, and that's just an example.
I think, you know, we have such great rehabilitative services.
Yes.
We have such And I think the big focus of the task force that I was on for the secretary was that we do have a lot of services between VHA, mm-hmm. healthcare, and also the benefits, but they're sometimes not very well coordinated. And so we're trying to really coordinate some of those, because it's like, well, where do you go to really get all of the healthcare and know all of, and or the benefits, and know which is the right place to go, and how do you do that? Hopefully, this will be a start actually to working with women veterans, but then enhance it to all of the veterans.
What's that saying? A journey starts with a small step.
It does. Very much so.
And if you're airborne, it jumps with one jump out the door. We talked real briefly what veterans organizations can do, and I think it's dependent that they have to know what's going on at the VA and then make that information available through their membership. And that's one way of starting it out in newsletters, their blog posts, or their websites, whatever they have. Would you say, before we close, would you say that Hines is better than any other VA facility in Illinois, or are you going to stay mute on that?
I'm the CEO of the Hines VA. It's the best.
There you go. I'll vouch for you on that. I'll join your corner. And in closing, I just want to say thank you very much. It was a pleasure. You're more than welcome to come back at any time. We'll have to keep this up because there's so much more to talk about. Thank you for joining us on this episode of Veterans Viewpoints. And folks, I got my book. I don't know about you, but you got to go to either Amazon.com or a bookstore. Best Care Anywhere, written by Philip Waugman. It's a whole book about how VA hospitals are incredibly functional and efficient in the delivery of health care. It's not what you think it is. It's actually a great place to get proper care. Thank you so much for joining
us.
It was a pleasure. I'm very happy. Folks, Ms. Joan Ricard, Chief Executive Officer, Director of Hines VA, get over there. And if you're not a registered veteran, register tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
See you next time.